Everyone, I can hear the bells on campus, so it is officially 7 o'clock and we will begin. First of all, I'd like to say welcome and thank you for joining us for our fourth lecture in our series of seven for 2020, Battle for the Soul of America. We appreciate you being here tonight and are glad to see that so many of you were able to join us. Looking in right now, we have nearly 90 folks joining us today online and from across the country. So it's an absolute pleasure to see everyone and to be able to host here from campus tonight. So we hope that you have enjoyed the series so far. Please note that before we begin the lecture, we do have a few housekeeping. This is being recorded and will be made available at the University of Puget Sound's Alumni and Parent Relations website at a later date. We will need to provide closed captioning, so it might not be ready until next week, but know that it will be available. Additionally, we will be having a Q&A session afterwards. During the lecture and during the Q&A session, we ask that all participants remain muted at this time so we don't have any disruptions that would take away from our two speakers. During the Q&A session, please feel free to either raise your hand or to write in the chat, and I will call upon you on first-come, first-served basis, so then we can make sure that everyone's question gets answered. And if not, we can then send all the questions to our two speakers and have them be able to follow up in time. With that, it is my pleasure to introduce Presidential Historian and Puget Sound alum, Mike Purdy, class of 1976 and Master's of Business Administration in 1979, as well as Professor Marco Artime, who is a Department Chair of Political Science at Pacific Lutheran University. So with that, please join me in welcoming our two guests with a warm lager welcome.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us. And thank you, Sam, for all of your assistance in making this work technologically. We, of course, would much rather be together in person, but this is a much safer venue for having the lecture now. So, you know, back when Michael and I were conceiving this lecture, you know, we did title it 2020 Battle for the Soul of America. And you've seen this electoral map before, and it is an electoral map from the 2016 election showing which counties Donald Trump won versus which ones Hillary Clinton won. And, you know, we really do have some very different sets of opinions in this nation that we somehow need to figure out a way to move toward. So let me just do a more detailed introduction of the two of us. So I'm Mike Purdy, a presidential historian. I wrote a book last year, it's been out about a year, 101 Presidential Insults, What They Really Thought About Each Other and What It Means to Us. And so it's a funny book, it's a sad book, it's you know, these are quotes that presidents have said about other presidents. And, but my main purpose in writing it was I wanted to use this historical context as a means to say, can we have a conversation in this nation about civility and how do we treat one another with respect and dignity? And so I talk about that in the introduction to the book. Got a website, PresidentialHistory.com, with a lot of resources out there if you are interested. And joining me tonight is my good friend, Dr. Michael Artime. who is the chairman of the political science department at Pacific Lutheran University, where he also teaches political science. So this is the fourth in a series of lectures, and we still have three more coming up this year, and I'm sure they will be eventful as well. And in addition to the video being posted on the university's website, it's also available on my website, PresidentialHistory.com.
See it, okay.
Resources. So we do want to try to make this nonpartisan to provide some contemporary analysis as well as historical insight. And so that's kind of our goal for the evening. So we're going to try to talk for maybe 60 or 75 minutes and allow plenty of time for questions and answers. Sam has already gone through the instructions about the questions at the end, and he will again talk with us about that. So let's take a look at the agenda for tonight. So I'm going to start off making some introductory comments. We want to talk about the protests and violence. We want to talk about what have been the president's responses to both the protests and the pandemic. Michael's going to guide us through looking at what's the current state of the race between Donald Trump and Joe Biden. I'm going to talk about the president's health and does it really matter, which is going to lead nicely into the question of vice presidential choices and mainly who is Joe Biden going to select as his vice presidential candidate. And then, you know, in the midst of a very difficult and challenging world, Michael and I will offer some reflections on reasons to be hopeful before we open it up for questions. So that's kind of our agenda for the evening. So I want to make a couple of introductory comments. So this lecture series is obviously about the 2020 presidential campaign, but it's not just about polls and advertising and rallies, because this is no ordinary campaign and it will be no ordinary election. And these are not ordinary times that we are living in. Our challenge tonight is to try to step back from the constant onslaught of shocking new developments in the news that come to us every day, and to try to put it in perspective. And Michael and I will do the best we can on that. Although it seems like an eternity ago, the year 2020 actually began with the impeachment of the president for tying the release of foreign aid to the Ukraine to their help in investigating his then likely rival for the presidency, Joe Biden. And then obstructing justice by refusing to respond to subpoenas for testimony from his administration officials or to provide documents that were requested by Congress. The president was, of course, acquitted by the Senate. A global pandemic has now taken the lives of too many of our loved ones and disproportionately hit older Americans and people of color, with the president declaring in mid-March that, quote, "I don't take responsibility at all," end quote, for the failure of the government to have a coordinated coronavirus testing program. For months, the president ignored COVID-19, declaring that it would suddenly and miraculously disappear and that everything was under control. And we'll look at some of his specific quotes on that later. He urged people to have disinfectants injected into their bodies or to try an unproven and potentially dangerous drug for treating the coronavirus. Now, sadly, some 120,000 Americans have died of the coronavirus, and this is the worst public health crisis in the world in more than a century. On the heels of COVID-19, our economy and the livelihood of our people have been shattered. With prudent measures to slow the spread of the coronavirus, by statewide lockdown orders that have devastated the finances of individuals and businesses alike. We are suffering from unemployment levels not seen for more than 90 years since the Great Depression. And in the last few weeks, added to the health and economic devastation, there have been widespread protests and social unrest that have shaken our nation as we have mutually tried to confront our racial history as a nation. For too long in our country, African Americans have continued to suffer from physical violence, death, and discrimination in a nation where we are still reeling from the consequences of the institution of slavery and still coming to grips with what it means that all people are created equal by God. And for too long, our nation has ignored those pleas for justice, equal justice under the law. Now, in times of challenges, America has generally been fortunate to have wise and principled men as president. George Washington established measured disciplines in the creation of our great American experiment. Abraham Lincoln was the right man at the right time as the nation was disintegrating over the issue of slavery. Franklin Roosevelt strategically led us through the Great Depression and World War II. Today we face challenges greater than those faced by any of these men or any other president. And yet we find ourselves with a president who lives by the marketing pitch for the day that will make him look strong and in charge while failing to intelligently and strategically wrestle with the challenges we face. His wishful thinking narrative and neglect of the office of the presidency have made our situation worse, and he has inflamed the public square with his vitriolic rhetoric that seeks to blame everyone except himself. A president who demands total loyalty to his factless style of attempting to govern. Truth doesn't seem to matter to him. It's all about his image and how he looks and whether his statements drive the daily headlines. If you are a supporter of President Donald Trump, I don't want to offend you with my comments, but I would invite you to examine the facts and not just his spin on the narrative he wants to be true. I would be glad to have an open and rational conversation with you. At the dawn of the Civil War, in Abraham Lincoln's first inaugural address, he said, "We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies." And I would put that out there for all of us to try to figure out as a nation how to come together. But historically, it is abundantly clear that America has never had a president like Donald Trump with dictatorial instincts and who is, quite frankly, in my opinion, a dangerous demagogue. A global pandemic, a severely depressed economy, racial unrest, a presidential campaign in which the impeached president is seeking another 4 years in the White House and will be holding a campaign rally on Saturday in a 19,000-person indoor venue, the prime breeding grounds for the spread of the coronavirus. And friends, the year isn't even quite half over. In 4.5 months, our world has been upended. None of us know what the next 4.5 months to the November 3rd election will bring. But it's probably fair to say that it will be unexpected. We used to talk about the October surprise in presidential elections, some shocking event in October that had the ability to upend the presidential race. today is not just the October surprise, but the 4.5 months of surprises that still face us. How will things turn out? Well, we just don't know. The historian David McCullough has this great quote about the challenge of writing history that I think is very applicable to our current day. He writes, "In writing history, to catch the feeling as well as the truth of other times, it is of utmost importance, I believe, to convey the sense that things need not have happened as they did. Life in other times past was never on a track any more than it is now or ever will be. The past, after all, is only another name for someone else's present. How would things turn out? They knew no better than we know how things will turn out for us." Again, while this lecture series is about the presidential campaign, we can't ignore what is going on in our country, as there are issues that will impact what people think of Donald Trump and Joe Biden. With that, I will turn it over to Michael to talk with us about the protests that have engulfed our nation after the murder of George Floyd in Minneapolis. Michael?
Thanks, Mike, and thank you all for being here tonight. But before I do that, just wanna say clearly and unequivocally that Black Lives Matter. This statement is not one that is revolutionary, but it represents the bare minimum, saying that the lives of our neighbors, friends, family members, and fellow citizens matter. However, unfortunately, Black individuals in this country are often at the front line of suffering, whether that be through police violence, the pandemic, housing discrimination, voter disenfranchisement. The list seems to go on and on. We want to be clear that we stand with those who say that this cannot be tolerated in a free society, and that until everyone is free, no one is free. In that vein, we encourage each of you to donate to or volunteer with an organization that is fighting for racial justice, the Equal Justice Initiative, Black Lives Matter, bail relief funds for those who have been arrested during protests, and many others. Likewise, we want to acknowledge that two white guys talking about racial justice is less than ideal. And in the future, we'll continue to look for ways to center the voices of people of color. And tonight, I've tried to include some of those voices in our lecture. I think it's important because we each need to consider ways that we can do better. It's far easier to point the finger at the worst of the worst, those individuals committing acts of violence against people of color. It's far more difficult, but nonetheless necessary, for each of us to engage in some thoughtful introspection about whether our lives are working to break down systemic racism. Ibram X. Kendi, in his book, How to Be an Anti-Racist, says that there are essentially two types of people. There are racists and anti-racists who are working to dismantle racism in all of its forms. In other words, you're either fighting racism or you're part of the problem. Tonight, I hope we can all begin by committing to being on the right and just end of that spectrum. One of the things that I have found hopeful and that I found helpful to think about is Martin Luther King's letter from a Birmingham jail in April of 1963. He writes this: "Beyond this, I am in Birmingham because injustice is here. Just as the 8th century prophets left their little villages and carried their thus saith the Lord far beyond the boundaries of their hometowns, and just as the Apostle Paul left his little village of Tarsus and carried the gospel of Jesus Christ to practically every hamlet and city of the Greco-Roman world, I too am compelled to carry the gospel of freedom beyond my particular hometown. Like Paul, I must constantly respond to the Macedonian call for aid. Moreover, I am cognizant of the interrelatedness of all communities and states. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Never again can we afford to live with a narrow, provincial, outside agitator idea. Anyone who lives inside the United States can never be considered an outsider anywhere in this country. So no matter where you land politically or what your views are about the criminal justice system, remember that we're all connected and we should be concerned with the pursuit of a world that is less unjust than when we arrived, in it. So as we think about the specific situation that occurred with George Floyd. George Floyd was a 46-year-old black man who police were called to a convenience store because the convenience store had indicated that he was using a counterfeit $20 bill. 17 minutes later, after the first squad car arrived at the scene, Mr. Floyd was unconscious and pinned beneath three police officers showing no signs of life. Many folks have seen the video, which is horrific, and ignited the anger of the entire nation. George Floyd is one of the many individuals who have been shot and killed by police in the past year. The Washington Post keeps a record of these incidents, and it's probably the most comprehensive record that we have. They indicate that 1,033 people have been shot and killed in the past year. That number, the number as they track it, is not abnormal. It seems as if the rate of police shooting is relatively stable over time, at least over time since the Post began this project. Also, what has remained stable is that individuals who are Black are much more likely to suffer at the hands of police, who are more likely to be victims of police violence than are persons who are white. Although half the people shot and killed by police are white, Black Americans are shot at a disproportionate rate. They account for less than 13% of the US population, but are killed by police at more than twice the rate of white Americans. Hispanic Americans are also killed by police at a disproportionate rate. One of the things that I think is important in understanding why folks are so angry about the criminal justice system is that this is not just about policing. This is about every aspect of the criminal justice system. So if we look at the amount of individuals who are incarcerated in this country, for example, compared to the rest of the world, we incarcerate 655 people per 100,000 people in this country. That is a greater rate than Russia, than Cuba. We regimes that we typically label as being oppressive, we imprison far more people in this country than they do. And those prison sentences disproportionately go to people of color in this country. And so if you look here, this is a distribution of prison sentences by the number of months that someone is in prison. And what you can see is that white Americans are more likely to serve shorter prison sentences for committing the same crimes than people of color. Additionally, when we look at plea offers, so this is a 2014 study of the New York criminal justice system involving felony crimes. 51% of white defendants who were convicted of a felony in New York during 2014 served a prison sentence. 74% of Black defendants served a prison sentence. So we're talking about the same crime and people being punished disproportionately for those crimes. This data from the Department of Justice demonstrates that Black men are incarcerated at 6 times the rate of white men. Additionally, 1 in 3 Black men in this country will at some point serve a prison sentence. again, this is about policing, and it is about police violence, but it's about so much more. It's about a system which punishes disproportionately, either through the policing process or through the criminal justice process, people of color at a disproportionate rate relative to white Americans. So people are angry, and there's been protests throughout the country. There's been protests in every single state. So each dot here represents one protest that has occurred in this country since the killing of George Floyd. And we've seen, and one of the hopeful things that I think we've seen is that support for things like Black Lives Matter have changed dramatically since the killing of George Floyd. So look at the majority of Americans in 2017 did not support the movement, and now it is overwhelmingly popular amongst the public. That's a relatively short period of time to see such a dramatic change in public opinion. But before we feel too good about that, this image here is of Rayshard Brooks from Atlanta. He's the gentleman that you've probably heard about in the news, who was shot in the back by police officers and killed. All of that, this incident happened after the protests. This incident happened after folks became more positive about the impact of Black Lives Matter. And so more needs to be done than just a shift in public opinion. But there actually has to be systemic change. Things have to change within the system. The way in which we engage in policing has to change, or else incidents such as this will continue to happen. These things have been happening for a long time. We can see them now. That's one of the big differences, because of cell phone videos, because of body cameras, because of dash cams. We can see these incidents occurring, but this has been happening for a long time. And I think it's important that we begin to say that this can't happen anymore. Because this is a lecture series about the presidency and presidential elections, I wanted to present this information so that we could set the stage for the political climate in which this election is occurring. And so to continue that work, I want to turn things over to Mike, who is going to talk a little bit about the president's response to these protests.
Thank you, Michael. So I think, as Michael framed it, this is really important to remember that this is one of the hot button issues that's going to shape this campaign and the election, along with the coronavirus and the economy. So before I talk about the president's response to the protests, and I'm primarily going to be using his words, and then I'll move into talking about the president's response to COVID-19. I just want to talk very briefly about what are some of the historical roles that the president is expected to play. These are not necessarily constitutional roles, but I think they're things that we generally would hope a president would do. So one is policy formulation, that the president would set the direction for what policy should be. The president would be persuasive, and he would work with the public and with Congress and with interest groups in trying to take issues, whether it's racial injustice or whatever it may be, and taking those issues and coming up with policies that are going to be for the greater good of our nation. The president also, I think, has historically been viewed as the comforter in chief, the one who in the times of national crisis is there to comfort people at their loss. And so that's a historical role. We expect the president to be good at governing, to have a steady hand at the mechanics of governing. And we expect the president to try to unify the nation, recognizing that we are a divided nation in many ways. So let's go on and take a look at the president's response or responses to the protests. So I want to use his actual words on his response to the protests. So Michael, if we go to the next slide. Okay. So last Friday, the president held an interview on Fox News with Harris Faulkner. And so I want to go through and I want to read Faulkner's question. And then I want to read the president's response. And then I want to try to offer a condensation outline or summary of what I think the president said. So Faulkner says to the president, "So I'm curious from you, what do you think the protesters, not the rioters and the looters, were intelligent enough to know the difference in our culture, right? What do you think they, the protesters, want? What do you think they need right now from you?" Here's what the president said. "Protesters for different reasons. You're protesting also because, you know, they just didn't know. I watched very closely. Why are you here? They really weren't able to say, but they were there for a reason, perhaps. But a lot of them really were there because they're following the crowd. A lot of them were there because what we witnessed was a terrible thing. What we saw was a terrible thing, and we've seen it over the years. We haven't, you know, this was one horrible example, but you've seen other terrible examples. You know better than anybody who would know it, and I know it. I've seen it too. I've seen it before I was president. I've seen it. I think it's a shame. I think it's a disgrace and it's got to stop." And one of the things about this comment here is where he talks about that it's a terrible thing that's happened. So it's one of the few times that he actually said it. "At the same time, you know, you also know that we have incredible people in law enforcement, that we have to cherish them and take care of them. And we can't let something like this, we have a bad apple, go out and, you know, destroy the image of a whole of millions of people that take really good care of us. And then you have a movement where they say, let's not have a police department. And you say, where are these people coming from?" So here's my summary of what I think the president was trying to say. And these are actually, you know, you can go back to the text there, and these are actually words that he used or concepts. Protesters are there for different reasons. Protesters don't know why they're protesting. Maybe some protesters have a reason. Protesters are just following the crowd. Protesters are there because we saw a terrible thing. We have to take care of the police. Some bad apple police, but we can't destroy the image of police. Some protesters say no police department. So it's a somewhat, in my opinion, disjointed response to the question. And I don't know that it really answered the question about what people expect, what things people expect from him as the president. So the president on May 28th did a series of tweets. And for the first time, Twitter put up a warning flag on it that the tweet violated Twitter's rules about glorifying violence. But they kept the tweet up, but they put the flag on there, which of course infuriated the president, caused him to sign an executive order directing the Justice Department to develop new guidelines on how social media platforms should function. And he got into kind of a Twitter war with Twitter. So he writes, "I can't stand back and watch this happen to a great American city, Minneapolis. A total lack of leadership. Either the very weak radical left mayor, Jacob Frey, get his act together and bring the city under control, or I will send in the National Guard and get the job done right." And right after that, he writes this. And again, this was also flagged by Twitter, and this is probably the one that is part of one tweet after another, but this is the one that caused a lot of consternation by the public, and I think caused Twitter to do the warning. He said, "These thugs are dishonoring the memory of George Floyd, and I won't let that happen. Just spoke to Governor Tim Walz of Minnesota and told him that the military is with him all the way. Any difficulty and we will assume control. But when the looting starts, the shooting starts. Thank you." So this phrase, "when the looting starts, the shooting starts," you know, has some historical background said by other folks. And it's, you know, Trump tried to explain what he meant about it, but most people interpret it as meaning if there's going to be looting, there's going to be shooting by the military. So one of the things that happened that I think is going to be an indelible image on President Trump's presidency is this picture. So let's just review the facts of what happened. The President of the United States, after giving a speech in the Rose Garden, used military force to clear peaceful protesters from Lafayette Park, which is next to the White House, so that the president could walk across Lafayette Park to St. John's Church, which had been partially burned by some of the rioters, and have a campaign event by holding up a Bible in front of the church. So what's wrong with this picture? So first, it's a violation of the First Amendment rights of people for peaceful assembly. And what's also happening here is that he is using the military to enforce that. So it's an inappropriate use of government resources that really goes against the right for peaceable assembly for the people. So we can ask the question, why did he do it? And there may be multiple answers to it. One, I think he wanted to send a message that in the midst of the protests that he was in charge, that he was in control. He had been disturbed by news reports that with the protests looming right outside the White House, that he had been advised by the Secret Service he and his family to go down to the bunker under the White House for their safety. And so he was concerned that the image of the president cowering in a bunker didn't project a picture of strength. And so he wanted to project a picture of strength and say, okay, I'm not afraid, I will go out there. He wanted to link the military and his top officials with his future. So he had them march across Lafayette Square with him. And then after his photo op here holding up the Bible, he ended up having a number of them, including the Attorney General and military officials, stand with him. General Miley has subsequently apologized and said that was an inappropriate use of the military for a campaign prop. But I think one of the main reasons for this campaign event may have been because he wanted to appeal to his core constituency, which is the white evangelical church in America, which is the people who really swung the election to him. And basically this was a bargain that he made with the evangelical church, many of whom were not and still are not happy with his behavior, his language, his lack of demonstration of faith. And And yet they struck a bargain with him essentially that said, okay, we'll elect you and you'll do for us the things that we want you to do, like appoint conservative justices to the Supreme Court. Move on to the next slide. So other reactions of the president to the protests. In a telephone call with governors, he says to them, you have to dominate or you'll look like a bunch of jerks. You have to arrest and try people, you have to dominate. So this is the president's modus operandi generally about being strong, dominating, being in control, regardless of the consequences. June 5th was an interesting day. So in the midst of a pandemic, an economic collapse, massive protests in the street, things that should be consuming the president's attention to try to solve the problems, the president of the United States spent his time doing what? Sending out 200 tweets or retweets. It was a record. June 9th, the president tweets, Buffalo protester shoved by police, could be Antifa provocateur. 75-year-old Martin Dugino was pushed away after appearing to scan police communications in order to black out the equipment. And this comes from One American News Network, which is his latest new favorite news outlet above Fox News, which has sometimes been critical of him recently. I watched. He fell harder than was pushed, was aiming a scanner. Could it be a setup? So this caused a lot of concerns by people. A number of you watched the video, I'm sure, of this. And so Trump is taking a conspiracy theory from a far right wing news network and pushing it out on Twitter. When asked about that tweet, Republican Senator Lisa Murkowski of Alaska only had this to say, oh Lord, ugh, why would you fan the flames? That's all I'm gonna say. So Trump's reactions to the protests, he's declared himself as the law and order president. He said that in his June 1st speech in the Rose Garden. He's appealing to his political base. Law and order is a code word for racism. It is something Richard Nixon employed in 1968. Trump threatens to take over cities and states to restore order, even though he does not have the power to do so. So all of this is about his re-election campaign and his image, not about unifying and uniting the country. James Mattis, the former Secretary of Defense, came out with a statement recently saying he's never seen a president who didn't try to unite the country, but that Trump is clearly not trying to do it. He is, as Senator Murkowski said, trying to fan the flames. So with the president's response, we see that there's a lack of a strategic response, and there's clearly a lack of a sympathetic response in terms of the tragedy of this. Because again, he's appealing to his base, which consists of the white evangelical church, and it also consists of gun owners. So there's a lot of talk about preserving the Second Amendment. There was a tweet today about that, and which was kind of inflammatory, talking about gun blasts. So he knows what he's doing from an image perspective here. So let's talk about the president's response to the coronavirus, to COVID-19. So in October 25th, 2018, Joe Biden, this is 2018, wrote this. He said, we are not prepared for a pandemic. Trump has rolled back progress President Obama and I made to strengthen global health security by cutting the office in the National Security Council dedicated to this. We need leadership that builds public trust, focuses on real threats, and mobilizes the world to stop outbreaks before they reach our shores. So that was Biden in 2018. Here's what Trump did. So he eliminated this group for global health and security and biodefense in 2018. And when he was asked about that in mid-March of this year at a press conference, he said that that was a nasty question and then responded saying, I don't know anything about it. The president's daily brief in January and February, every day the president is supposed to get a daily briefing on security issues, threats to the country. In those 2 months, it included more than a dozen warnings about the coronavirus. Trump has been known to be very impatient with these briefings. He's only getting them a couple of times a week now. So I'm gonna, in a minute, I'm gonna share with you some of Trump's statements about the coronavirus. And we could also compare those statements up against that of the CDC and other medical professionals, and it's a very different picture. Those are based on facts. Trump's is based on his wishful thinking. January 22nd this year, Trump tweets, we have it, COVID-19, totally under control. It's one person coming in from China and we have it under control. It's gonna be just fine. And then at the bottom of each of these quotes, you'll see the U.S. death rate and the number of U.S. cases. And I'm not going to read those. You can just see that. January 23rd, China has been working very hard to contain the coronavirus. The United States greatly appreciates their efforts and transparency. It will all work out well. In particular, on behalf of the American people, I want to thank President Xi. Well, that's a very different response than what we get later from him when things start going bad and he begins to blame the Chinese about the virus. February 10th, looks like by April, you know, in theory, when it gets a little warmer, it miraculously goes away. February 24th, the coronavirus is very much under control in the USA. CDC and World Health, who he's speaking about very favorably now, but later, because things aren't going well, Trump's mode of operation is to blame other people. And so he's pulled funding from the World Health Organization and wants to pull out from participation there. So CDC and World Health have been working hard and very smart. Stock market starting to look very good to me. February 27th, it's going to disappear. One day, it's like a miracle. It will disappear. March 6th, anybody that wants to test can get a test. That's what the bottom line is, not a factual statement. March 10th, this was unexpected and it hit the world and we're prepared and we're doing a great job with it and it will go away. Just stay calm. It will go away. It wasn't unexpected. March 15th, this is a very contagious virus. It's incredible, but it's something that we have tremendous control over as the number of cases and the death rate continues to rise. I always treated the Chinese virus very seriously. So now he's starting to, his blame on the Chinese government for it by starting to call it the Chinese virus instead of the coronavirus. I've always treated it very seriously and have done a very good job from the beginning. March 25th, nobody would ever believe a thing like that's possible. Nobody could have ever seen something like this coming. But now we have, but now we know, and we know it can happen and happen again. And yet information was out there in the presidential daily brief that he failed to pay attention to. I haven't included all of his statements. That would take up far more time than we have. But May 24th, the U.S. nears and then shortly after hit 100,000 deaths from the coronavirus. And we're at 120,000 now. So in some ways, the president is missing what I call the empathy gene. And I want to just make a couple of comments on this, that so on April 30th, Trump made one of his comments that are just full of hyperbole. And he said this, he says, "I don't think anybody can feel any worse than I do about all of the death and destruction that's so needless. Nobody." Well, this statement in and of itself demonstrates his lack of empathy. You know, I think there are some people, like 100,000 families, who could feel worse than he does about the death and loss of loved ones, not to count friends and coworkers of these people who have died. So rather than, you know, he's really failing in his job as comforter in chief, and he's doing really well as narcissist in chief. So this quote here on the screen comes from Timothy Naftali, who's a presidential historian at New York University. He writes that Trump's public response to the virus reaffirmed that he has no empathy, isn't interested in developing a national consensus for healing, that he needs attention, that he's unwilling to share the spotlight with the real heroes. Donald Trump is a victim of his own shortcomings, and we're all paying the price. So in announcing CDC guidelines for wearing masks on May 26, Trump said, and I think this was a Rose Garden press conference, he says, "It's voluntary. You don't have to do it. They suggest it for a period of time, but this is voluntary. I don't think I'm going to be doing it." So one of the roles of the president is to set an example. And this is something that he has not done, setting an example to help contain the virus. On Saturday, the president will hold a rally in Tulsa. I think Michael's going to talk about it a little bit more later, but this is in a 19,000 person indoor venue, and people will have the option whether they want to wear masks or not. There'll be a lot of shouting and cheering. That's the prime way in which the virus spreads, is through droplets coming from someone's mouth. But this is it's about the campaign. It's about him, and not necessarily about the good of the country. So we talked a little bit before about October surprises, and you know, it wouldn't surprise me if in October the president announces that there is now a vaccine for COVID-19 that is ready for use. Now, fact is, that statement may not be true. If it is true, that would be wonderful news. But the president has a tendency to want to grab the headlines with things that will help push his poll numbers and approval ratings up, whether it has any basis in truth or not. So Michael, tell us about the current state of the election, the race, and who's leading, and what's going on.
Great, thanks, Mike. If we look at recent information from 538.com, where they're analyzing some polls from some key states, it looks like Biden is doing pretty well in states like Michigan, Wisconsin, Arizona, Florida, has a slight lead in North Carolina and Pennsylvania, and even in places where you would expect Trump to be doing pretty well, like Texas, Trump's lead is relatively small. So of the three polls that they have in Texas, averaging them together, it looks like Trump has about a point and a half advantage right now. And so, and a 1 point advantage in Georgia. That's not great. If you are an incumbent Republican president, his approval ratings are pretty bad right now as well. I think one of the questions going forward is, you know, is this a blip? Is he particularly unpopular given all the things that are happening right now? And then perhaps, you know, the state of, you know, the sort of political landscape changes between now and the election. There's plenty of time for that to happen. Does his approval increase and we see these numbers kind of change around a bit? I think that remains to be seen. I went ahead and I took the most recent averages from 538.com and from Real Clear Politics, where 538 averages were not available. And this would be the Electoral College map if the election was held today, and those numbers were correct. That takes a lot of things. I'm assuming a lot of things there, but just to give you a sense of what the race might look like today, this is what they would look like with Biden having 333 electoral votes, Trump with 203. There's two toss-up electoral votes there. That is for Nebraska's second district and Maine's second district, because they don't have winner-take-all apportionment of electoral votes in those states, and there isn't district-level polling that I am aware of as of yet there. I'm not saying this is a prediction. This is a snapshot of where the race might be at this particular moment. As I mentioned just a moment ago, lots of things can change between today and tomorrow, much less today and election day. We've seen lots of things happen that the world look considerably different than it did at the beginning of the year. And as Mike demonstrated earlier on in the lecture, we're a far way off from election day. I also just wanted to give you a sense of what campaigning is looking like right now. Right now, I think that there's a lot of question about, you know, what campaigning, what the 2020 election is going to look like moving forward. I think that the Trump campaign seems to be pivoting toward things going back to normal. So holding large rallies, for example. Trump likes large rallies as a way to generate enthusiasm. I think he, in some ways, just likes doing these large rallies. You saw him continue to do them even after the election was over in 2016. So I think that is where they are sort of pivoting. The campaign also has lots of money. And so there's going to be a lot of advertising from the Trump campaign moving forward. They have so much money that they have spent even some of that money running ads in DC, where they are definitely going to lose because they thought it would boost the president's spirits to have positive campaign ads playing in a place where he was likely to be watching television. And so the Trump campaign is holding their first big rally since the pandemic. They held a rally, I think, earlier on when the pandemic was first beginning, but the first one since sort of nationwide stay-at-home orders were in place. And let me read you just the beginning of this article from the New York Times by Noah Weiland. It says, officials in Tulsa, Oklahoma are warning that President Trump's planned campaign rally on Saturday, his first in over 3 months, is likely to worsen an already troubling spike in coronavirus infections and could become a disastrous super spreader. They are pleading with the Trump campaign to cancel the event slated for a 20,000 person indoor arena, or at least move it outdoors. It's the perfect storm of potential over-the-top disease transmission, said Bruce Dart, the executive director of the Tulsa Health Department. It's a perfect storm that we can't afford to have. Tulsa County, which includes the city of Tulsa, tallied 89 new coronavirus cases on Monday. It's one day high since the virus's outbreak, according to the Tulsa Area Emergency Management Agency. The number of active coronavirus cases climbed to 532 from 188 in a one-week period, 182% increase. Hospitalizations with COVID-19 almost doubled. So the president is going into an area where COVID-19 is already spreading. And it's already getting worse, and holding an event which professionals are saying could be a super spreader of the disease. This is both dangerous in and of itself, and it's a dangerous example to set. As Mike was saying, we look to the president to set an example during times like this. If the CDC says wear a mask, you would expect an administration to do lots of events highlighting the importance of wearing a mask, having officials within the administration wearing masks to demonstrate that, you know, it's the right thing to do. And you see the president here kind of flouting his own CDC's guidelines in really dangerous ways. In contrast, Obama is going to be headlining a virtual fundraiser for Biden next week. This is one of several virtual fundraisers that the Biden campaign has put on in recent weeks. I know that Elizabeth Warren recently did one for him as well. Biden is still trailing Trump in terms of fundraising. One thing that might help Biden, even though he is at a fundraising disadvantage, there are some groups which are organizing, which are running ads on Biden's behalf. I think Mike will show you an ad from one of those groups here shortly. So maybe that will shrink the advantage a bit with respect to fundraising and the importance of it in the election. So I want to go ahead and turn things over to Mike. There's been a lot of talk this last week about the president's health, and we wanted to kind of step back and think about why do these conversations matter, if they matter at all.
Thank you, Michael. So yeah, we do want to think about the president's health. I mean, we do have to remember older presidents have generally not fared very well. So Trump is the oldest man to ever assume the presidency for a first term. And there are some concerns about his mental capacity as well as physical decline. And there's a number of news stories about that. I'll show you a video on it, an advertisement, but you know, there's been concerns about that he is unsteady on his feet. He has tremors in terms of being able to lift up a glass to his mouth for drinking. And the fact is, we don't really know anything about the president's health because he's not forthcoming about that, or other important things that the American people deserve to know, like his finances. Ronald Reagan, who before Trump was the oldest president elected to a first term, he began showing signs of dementia during his term of office. William Henry Harrison, who for many, many years, so Harrison is in 1820, or 1840, I guess, 1840, you know, dies in office after just 32 days as president. And so, and that record of being the oldest president held until Ronald Reagan in 1980. James Buchanan, 65, was a very ineffective president. He had a wonderful resume, and he should have been a stellar president, but instead he is generally rated by historians as the worst president ever. We've yet to see historians weigh in on the Trump presidency, but I would venture to guess that on the factors that are used to evaluate a president's effectiveness, I don't think Trump is going to fare particularly well. George H.W. Bush is next, and there were no age-related issues that we knew about. Zachary Taylor died in office. So the president's age does matter. I mean, this is and health matters, that this is an incredibly stressful job. It's become much more stressful as the years have gone on. And so we need to make sure we have somebody who is in good health. So four presidents have died in office. And we talked about William Henry Harrison and Zachary Taylor, but in addition, Warren Harding and Franklin Roosevelt died in office. So that's about 10% of the presidents. So we do have examples of presidents who have struggled with health issues. And in a lot of these cases, the presidents withheld that information from the American people. Most people don't know or didn't know then that Abraham Lincoln suffered from severe depression, or Franklin Pierce did, whose 11-year-old son was killed before his eyes just months before his inauguration, or that Calvin Coolidge sunk into a deep depression after his son died in the White House, his teenage son. Grover Cleveland had throat cancer, had a secret surgery on the presidential yacht to address it, and that news didn't come out for many, many years. Now, I'm talking about presidents who have died in office. I gave you four presidents who died in office. They're the presidents who died of natural causes. And of course, we've had four presidents who were also assassinated. Woodrow Wilson suffered a debilitating stroke during the last year and a half or so of his presidency. And many people think that his wife essentially ran the government, and that information was kept from people. People didn't know that Franklin Roosevelt had polio. They didn't know, except for very close people around him, that when he ran in 1944, that he was probably not going to make it through that term. He was a very, very sick man. Dwight Eisenhower had a heart attack as president, but he's a good example, though. He was very transparent and open about it. John Kennedy had Addison's disease and covered that up. And so we have to ask the question, given President Trump's age, given kind of the history of presidents not disclosing their health, but the huge impact that it has on the nation, are there things that Trump is hiding? So we do have in this election the two oldest candidates in history. At the end of their term, so in 2025, depending who's elected, in 2025, Trump would be 78, Biden would be 82. But Trump has not been transparent about his health and not provided what's typically considered to be hard data about someone's health. I want to show you a video. This is a campaign ad put out by a group called the Lincoln Project. They have a number of videos. These are Michael was talking about the fundraising advantage that Trump has, but that there are a number of groups that are doing advertising basically on Biden's behalf. The Lincoln Project is one of those. There's another group called Republicans Against Trump. And so let's just watch this. I think it's like a 45-second video.
Something's wrong with Donald Trump. He's shaky, weak, trouble speaking, trouble walking. So why aren't we talking about this? And why isn't the press covering Trump's secretive midnight run to Walter Reed Medical Center? Why do so many reporters who cover the White House pretend they can't see Trump's decline? The most powerful office in the world needs more than a weak, unfit, shaky president. Trump doesn't have the strength to lead, nor the character to admit it. We're not doctors, but we're not blind. It's time we talk about this. Trump is not well. Something's...
So the health of presidential candidates, does matter. I mean, I think we ought to actually have a law that requires certain disclosure about the health of the president as well as their finances. I mean, the American people are hiring somebody to run the government, a huge, huge enterprise. And we need to know about their health, and we need to know who they may be beholden to or not beholden to financially. So health does matter about the president, and so does the vice president as a result. And Michael's going to take us through some thinking about who is Joe Biden going to select as his vice presidential running mate. Michael?
Thanks, Mike. Yeah, I think that given Biden's age, there's always a lot of attention being paid to who the candidate is going to select as vice president. But I think that there's perhaps even more attention this time because of his age, and because there's been some rumors that perhaps he wouldn't serve a second term. Maybe he would only serve as one term, making the person that he selects as vice president the presumptive nominee of the party in 2024. And so I think that makes this selection, at least perceptually, a really important one. This article is one that was on 538. It's written by William Adler and Julia Azari. They're both political scientists, and Perry Bacon Jr., who writes for the website. They kind of try to put themselves in the shoes of the Biden campaign, analyzing the strengths and weaknesses of different candidates. But they do present a caveat at the beginning of their article that the data on whether vice presidential selections matter is pretty mixed. For example, in a new book called Do Running Mates Matter by political scientists Christopher Devine and Kyle Kopko, they argue that picking candidates from particular regions of the country does not help candidates win that region. In fact, they argue that it doesn't even help the candidate win the vice president's home state. They do argue that one of the important factors in vice presidential selection processes is that they shed a light on the candidate's ability to make decisions. So for example, they make the argument that McCain's selection of Palin was harmful to him because it called into question his judgment. Whereas other academics, so for example, Boris Hirschkin and Brenton Peterson argue that choosing a vice president can help you win 2 to 3 percentage points in the vice president's home state. Which, you know, in close elections would be important. And so the data in the political science literature is relatively mixed. But they kind of try to put themselves in the position of the campaign and say, how do they think the campaign will try to make this decision? And so they identify 4 goals that the campaign might have in trying to decide who the running mate should be. I should start by just, reminding you that Biden has already said that he is going to pick a woman. And so so that is sort of baked into this selection process. So all of the potential candidates that I'll be talking about are women. And so the first goal is to help with electability, real or imagined. So this is the idea that selecting a candidate might help you win that candidate's home state. And so if that is paramount in the thinking of the campaign, then they might select somebody like Senator Tammy Baldwin of Wisconsin. Baldwin is the first openly gay person elected to the U.S. Senate, first woman elected to the Senate from the state of Wisconsin, and would be a good pick if the campaign believes that picking a vice president from a swing state is going to help them win that state. Could also pick Amy Klobuchar of Minnesota or Michigan Governor Gretchen Whitmer. They would both, they would all, according to that theory of the case, be helpful in contributing to the candidates' efforts in those respective states. Oh, and in it, as it mentions here, that doesn't help somebody like Elizabeth Warren from the state of Massachusetts, which would already go to the Democratic candidate, but in all likelihood. So goal two might be to balance the ticket demographically, particularly on questions of race and ethnicity. And so that would help candidates like Cortez Masto, who is the first woman elected to the Senate from Nevada and also the first Latina to serve in the Senate, or Tammy Duckworth of Illinois, who was the first Thai American woman elected to Congress, the first woman with a disability elected to serve in Congress, the first senator to give birth while in office, or Governor Grisham, who is the governor of New Mexico, is the first Democratic woman to serve as governor of the state, first Latina governor of the state as well. Kamala Harris, the senator from California, fresh off a losing bid to become the Democratic Party nominee in 2020. Stacey Abrams, who most recently ran for governor of Georgia and is involved in voting rights activism throughout the country. And it would hurt basically any candidate who didn't balance the ticket demographically. So Tammy Baldwin, Amy Klobuchar, Elizabeth Warren, Gretchen Whitmer, as it says here, basically any candidate who is white. Goal three might be to balance the ticket ideologically. So Biden is considered moderate. So if you want to balance the ticket ideologically, maybe you pick somebody who is seen as more liberal. That would help Stacey Abrams, Kamala Harris, Elizabeth Warren, but it wouldn't help Amy Klobuchar, who is seen as kind of similar to Biden with respect to their political leanings. And fourth, the fourth goal could be to help Democrats gain a Senate majority. And so the idea here is that you would pick somebody from a state that is already going to vote for a Democratic candidate, right? So you might pick Tammy Duckworth from Illinois. Illinois is going to go for the Democratic candidate. Her replacement is likely to be a Democrat. Kamala Harris from California, you pick her, her replacement in California is likely to be a Democrat. It doesn't hurt the Democratic Party's chance of gaining control of the Senate. Whereas if you pick Elizabeth Warren, for example, in Massachusetts, her seat could be a competitive seat, and perhaps that seat could be filled with a Republican, which would undermine the Democratic Party's chance of holding a Senate majority. In this article, they say Harris, out of those four categories, three positives, no negatives. Abrams, two positives, no negatives. Duckworth, two positives, no negatives. Klobuchar, one positive, two negatives. And Warren, one positive, three negatives. This, of course, does not mean that Biden is going to pick Harris. I think that in a time of a great deal of unrest around issues of race, it makes a lot of sense to pick a woman of color. However, I think that whether they pick Harris will depend in part on how they can frame her career as a prosecutor. Harris has tried to depict herself as a progressive prosecutor. However, others have questioned whether that moniker fits. If she's framed as being so-called tough on crime, it might make the campaign wary of selecting her in the wake of increased scrutiny over the way that these sorts of policies have disproportionately harmed minority communities. Either way, we're going to find out later this summer, as the campaign has suggested that they're not going to make a decision until sometime around August. So we wanted to end tonight. Things are dark, both in terms of the police violence, systemic racism that we are thinking about and grappling with as a country, in terms of the pandemic, where it seems as if we might head into another wave and face some similar things that we saw earlier on this spring. And so we wanted to end with some reasons to be hopeful. And I thought I'd turn it over to Mike first. Do you want to talk a little bit about some ideas that you have, some direction that you might give to the listeners?
Yeah, it's a great question. What are the reasons for hope? And I guess for me, I would sum it up that I think the truth is going to come out. I think the truth is coming out about the current presidency. You know, you have a number of former defense and security officials who have come out against Trump, who have said, you know, he's not qualified or capable to be president. These are Republicans who are saying this. You've got, even there's some movement in the Republican U.S. Senate about starting to buck President Trump on certain issues as they see what he's really doing. We've got a book that's going to be published on Tuesday by former National Security Advisor John Bolton. And you've all read probably pieces of that have been leaked out a little bit. New York Times got an advanced copy of it. And the picture that is presented of the president is not particularly flattering. And this isn't a big surprise, actually. It's other people have said this as well. You've got, I think it's in August, Trump's niece, Mary Trump, is publishing a family tell-all book about Donald Trump, and with details that, you know, many of us either know about or have speculated about. The Supreme Court is going to be ruling soon about whether Trump's tax returns need to be disclosed in response to subpoenas from Congress or from the state of New York. Now, we don't know how the court is going to rule, but there have been a couple of kind of surprise rulings from a fairly conservative court within the last couple of weeks. One is about DACA, the Dreamers, obviously, and one is about LGBTQ rights, that the Civil Rights Act protects them against discrimination. And that majority opinion was written by Neil Gorsuch, conservative who was appointed by Trump. So in one sense, it seems like there's kind of a wave of more facts coming out about the president. And that gives me hope. And I also hope that Republicans in Congress and Republicans across the country, including and especially the white evangelical church, will look at what their values are and realize what kind of president we have now. Michael?
Yeah. Thanks, Mike. Yeah, I think that for me, it's difficult because if, you know, as I think about issues of like systemic racism, or think about issues of like trying to address a pandemic using a government that in some ways has seemed uninterested in governing, or at least having a difficult time governing. As I think about those things, you know, sort of analytically, it's difficult to generate hope. And it brings me to this idea of hope being being a choice that we can choose. We can choose to be hopeful, even in the face of evidence that suggests maybe hope is the wrong disposition. And so the quote that I come back to at that, and something that's been really helpful to me in moments that seem particularly dark, is a quote from Cornel West. And he says, "Hope and optimism are different. Optimism tends to be based on the notion that there's enough evidence out there to believe things are going to be better, much more rational, deeply secular, whereas hope looks at the evidence and says, it doesn't look good at all, Gonna go beyond the evidence to create new possibilities based on visions that become contagious, to allow people to engage in heroic actions, always against the odds, no guarantee whatsoever. That's hope. I'm a prisoner of hope, though, going to die a prisoner of hope. To me, living a life of hope against the odds seems better than the alternative. And so that's where I'll leave things off today. So this is us. We have some contact information here that you are you're free to give us shoot us an email and or follow us on Twitter and let us know what questions you have and interact with us, and we'll continue this conversation. You should, as always, buy Mike's book, which is entertaining and funny, and the comments at the beginning have been a source of hope for me in this last year, and so worth the read. And I think we are at our time for questions. So I'll turn things over to Sam, who is going to help navigate that process for us.
Yes, great, thank you. So first of all, I'd just like to take a moment to give you both a round of applause. As always, it's great to be able to hear your insight, especially in preparing for the election coming up. With that, we have gone over time for a little bit, so we will go through a few questions, but I would say that if you want to make sure that your question is answered, please put that into the chat. We'll extend it for as long as possible, but I also understand that it is 8:30 at this point. We do have one question from Marcella. Marcella, I'm going to unmute you, and please feel free to ask your question.
Hi. My name is Marcella. I was in the class of 2017 at Puget Sound. My question is geared a little bit towards Mike, and it's because my personal favorite VP pick is Stacey Abrams, and a lot of concerns about her have been about her lack of like federal experience in government. And I'm wondering if you can speak to whether that's been important in the past or whether like state legislative experience can be considered enough to be the vice president. Thanks.
Great question.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting question. I think that it depends on who's at the top of the ticket. So I think the reason that she is, the reason that she's getting that scrutiny is partly because of Biden's age, right? That like, he's old, so people think, you know, there's a chance he wouldn't complete his term. And so, if so, you would want somebody who is experienced in that position. Although I've also heard the argument that, you know, do you want to balance the ticket with somebody else who is also in their 70s or in their 80s, which, you know, some of the people that are on the list are part of that. And so would it be better for him to pick? I think the case for her is, pick the future of the party, right?
Exactly.
That he said that his goal is to serve as a bridge, right? Like his argument is elect me, like, and I'll be the bridge to the future of the Democratic Party. Like I'm basically a stopgap, like use me to get rid of Trump and then I will then set the stage for the next wave of Democrats. And if that's the case, like you can see where Stacey Abrams would make, you know, where there would be the argument for her that, like, if she is the future of the party, select her as VP and set her up well to run in 2024. And so I think that would be the best case for her. It sounds like she hasn't been vet. So I know that Klobuchar was vetted or said that she was being vetted. And Abrams said that she has not been yet. But it's very difficult to read too much into that because the vice presidential selection process is one of the most secretive processes that we have in American politics. And so we don't really know very much about what's going on.
Yeah, Klobuchar actually announced that she was withdrawing her name during this lecture.
Oh, really?
Oh.
Yeah, she's removed herself because I think she was prosecutor or DA or something when a lot of Derek Chauvin's cases were up and she declined to prosecute him.
Okay.
She removed herself. So, I don't know.
I'll go back and edit this, and then I'll do it again. So. Yeah.
Thank you.
And for the breaking news.
She also, sorry, I'm just adding. This is okay if I add in, but she wrote also that she wanted a woman of color to be picked as Joe Biden's running mate. She like
that was part of her withdraw from consideration.
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting.
Sorry about that. It looks like for user Max, I accidentally hit mute on you. Did you have any additional follow up?
No, there's no follow up. I just wanted to.
No, thank you for chiming in on that.
The next question comes from the chat. Clay has written his question in the chat. However, Clay, I'm going to ask that you unmute so you can ask in person. If you don't feel comfortable, I'm happy to read it for you.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
All right, my question. A lot of time was spent tonight on Trump's weaknesses, including his health and his age. But can you please address Biden's weaknesses, including his health and age? And I think it's worth diving a little more deeply on which of Biden's vice presidential options would be the best as president if Biden doesn't make it past a term or less.
Mike, do you want to take the first part of that?
Sure. So, am I on here, Sam?
You're alive.
Okay. So, I think that Biden clearly has some challenges. Obviously, he is even older than Trump. He, you know, by all accounts, he is pretty fit for a 77-year-old. I think one of Biden's weaknesses is the fact that he ends up saying some things that are what we would call gaffes. But, you know, and some people might say that, well, that's because he's so old. But I think you can go back and look at Biden's career, and this is just how he comes across. That's certainly not ideal in a president, but I think it's on a much, much, much lower scale than the kinds of things that we get from the current president.
Yeah, in terms of which vice president would be best at governing, it's, I think, difficult to say. What I can say is that there's different theories of that, right? That so I would say that there's sort of the experience, like, so you could say, like, the person who's going to be best as president, if they were to be president, I like to think of it as like experience versus judgment, right? That, like, experience on one hand would be like, you know, you'd want somebody who's, for example, been governor, right? Because it is an executive office. You've run lots of different agencies. You've engaged in policymaking in a similar way in which a president would engage in policymaking. Whereas, you know, you could make an argument that, well, experience isn't as important as judgment. You're making lots of decisions. We want to see what kind of decision maker you are. I think back to like the 2008 presidential election between Hillary Clinton and Obama. And that's, I think, one of the clearest examples of this distinction. So Hillary Clinton was making the case for experience, right? An in-depth knowledge of the policy process, a knowledge of how the different agencies of government work. And so that as a reason why you should vote for her to be president. Whereas Obama was saying, like, well, what's more important is judgment. And particularly, he continued to go back to, like, I voted against the Iraq war, right? Like, I have less experience, but votes on things like this demonstrate that when tough policy questions come to me, I'm going to make the right decision there. And so I think of those as kind of the contrast. And I'll leave it up to you all to decide who you think would be the best president out of that group.
Thank you. Next in the chat, we have a question from the Tomlin family. Tomlin family, I'm going to ask for you to unmute as well. There we go.
Okay. Thank you. Michael and Michael, could you address what might happen if the president were to become severely disabled or die before Election Day, please?
I'll go ahead and take that one. So we've not ever had that happen. There was a vice presidential candidate in the early part of the 1900s who ended up dying a few days before the election, was not the winning candidate. But what would happen is, so if you have Trump dying, let's make it easy for right now. After he's been formally nominated, then it really goes back to the Republican National Committee to decide who the candidate is going to be for president. And of course, once the president dies, then the vice president takes over. So president dies before Election Day, Pence becomes president, and then the Republican National Committee would have to make a decision, is Pence at the top of the ticket or somebody else? If Pence is at the top of the ticket, who's the vice presidential candidate? And it would be fairly chaotic, to say the least. But generally, that would be the framework of what would happen.
It's a confusing constitutional question, particularly if the president, if the nominee is already on ballots, that makes it confusing. And, you know, you could have a dead candidate win the election. And so then you would expect, for example, perhaps the party suggests somebody else is the nominee, maybe the person who is currently vice president, and the electors could, because they are unbound, cast their votes for that person. Since they're party loyalists, you would assume that they would follow the party's direction, but that could get awfully messy too.
Great, thank you. Next, we have another question in the chat from Paul Miller. Paul, I'll ask if you will unmute. Paul, I think that we can hear you now.
All right, can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, we've listed several of, actually I have two questions, but anyway, we've listed lots of Donald Trump's miscues, mistakes, so on and so forth. But has he done anything positive for the country or for the world? Can you think of any one? I'll take one. And both Michaels, I'd like to hear your response to that question, please. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
All right.
Do you want to go first, Mike, or do you want me?
Sure. I'll take a stab at it. So
the guy with the M in his first name can go first.
So I'll go first. If that's okay, Michael.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. So I think that you know, there have been a lot of negatives from my perspective about the Trump presidency. I think one of the things that he has done well on, and that he's, you know, he's a genius at, is setting the narrative and marketing things. And I think the tragedy, however, is sometimes that hasn't necessarily been for the country's good, but for his own good more. But I think he's a genius. I've always said that, at being able to understand at a very gut level what at least a portion of the nation is looking for, and being a very in tune politician from that perspective.
Yeah, so as we think about like criminal justice issues, I mean, I don't think that he was intimately involved in the policy process here, but he did sign the First Step Act, which was I think it's like it sounds. It's not the be all end all of criminal justice reform, but it was, I think, a positive first step. And he signed that. And so I think if you're looking for areas of hope, at least in the past, Democrats and Republicans have been able to find some common cause on criminal justice questions, not necessarily policing questions, but in terms of sentencing reform and those sorts of efforts. You know, perhaps that's something that we could find again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Paul, I'm gonna mute you if you're okay with that.
Yep, go, sure.
Thank you. Our next question comes from the chat as well, from Linda and George Lamb. I will ask you two to unmute.
Well, Linda, it's the question that it's very similar to the previous question about what would happen if the president decides he's not going to run at the convention, or that the R's decide he is unfit and choose someone else. What are your thoughts?
Well, you know, I talked about October surprises and 4.5 months of surprise, and these are both questions that get at that potentiality. And, you know, they very well could happen. And I mean, I think the tragedy is we're at a fairly fragile place as a nation right now. And so adding some of these things would be challenging. But from a mechanical perspective, if either the president decided not to run when the convention happens, or the Republicans decided not to nominate him, both of which I think are probably not super realistic options. I think Trump is very concerned about running and winning. The Republicans to date haven't shown an ability or willingness to call him on the carpet for certain things. But if that did happen, then it would be a free-for-all, and the Republicans would end up needing to make some decisions. So basically what you'd have is Trump going into the, let's split this out. Trump decides not to run. He's got the votes for the nomination. So he then can encourage his delegates to vote for somebody else. Now, whether that is Mike Pence or somebody else, we don't know. And then there's going to be a vice presidential decision. I don't know that there are any realistic mechanical options available, even if the Republicans decided he was unfit and didn't want to nominate him, because by their own rules right now, the candidate with the majority of the delegates is nominated. If he's not nominated on the first ballot somehow, if the Republicans change their rules to permit delegates to be free agents instead of bound by the votes in each of the primaries, then you would have an open or brokered convention. And again, anything could happen. Mike Pence could come out on top. Somebody else could come out on top. Makes my head hurt thinking about these options. Yes.
Well, is there any candidate that would seem to be a forerunner if that chaos happened and there was there was a need for a unification, which would be obvious.
Yeah.
Do you see a potential Republican that could pull that off?
Yeah. So a couple of thoughts. One is to say that if the convention says that Trump is, you know, not fit, and they're able to figure out the rules mechanisms so that agent or delegates can be free agents, logically you'd look at Mike Pence, but you might also then say Pence is damaged goods because of his affiliation with Trump and the Trump administration. A lot of people have said that Nikki Haley may be the future face of the Republican Party. Mm-hmm. Haley would help a lot in terms of votes with women that Trump is losing by fairly large margins right now in the polls. You know, the Republicans could go with some other compromise candidate. I mean, it all really depends where they're coming from. I mean, in a lot of respects, Mitt Romney looks like a would be a very difficult candidate to beat. I think he would be the toughest candidate for Joe Biden to beat is Mitt Romney.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We have another question from Lisa. Lisa, let me find you here and I will unmute you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for the great lecture. I would love to hear your thoughts on if and how you think foreign interference might play in the 2020 election.
Well, I think that it will play a part. You know, I don't think that we have gotten to the bottom of what really happened in 2016. I think that's been obscured some. I think you look at the reasons for impeachment of the president, where the president, the charges were that he was using a foreign power to investigate a potential rival. New things coming out with John Bolton's recent book saying that Trump has gone to the president of China to ask for re-election help. I think it's going to be a factor in terms of the president asking for foreign leaders' help. And I think it's going to be a factor with misinformation campaigns on social media by foreign governments. So it's definitely going to be a factor. I don't think we're going to know the full extent of that for years to come as history kind of unpacks the facts and as more truth comes out.
Yeah, I think what worries me is I think it will definitely happen. There's some debate in the literature about whether or not Russian interference in 2016 influenced the outcome of the election. I think many folks believe that it didn't change who was going to win the election. It's a really hard thing to tell. I know that Kathleen Hall Jamieson, who is a communication scholar, wrote a book arguing that it had changed the outcome of the election. So there's at least some people that are making that argument. But I think one of the things that's scary is that because of the outcome of impeachment and our just sort of acceptance of foreign interference and the sort of tacit approval of the president soliciting foreign interference, we've not only encouraged candidates and in particular Trump to solicit foreign interference, but we've also we're not taking it seriously. And whatever methods were used by Russia, for example, in 2016, you can bet that they're going to improve on those over time. And that other countries that might interfere in the election will improve on what Russia did in 2016. And if we're not taking it seriously, then those efforts will get more and more sophisticated over time. And so it is, I fear, one of the long-term really damaging things that has come out of the presidency.
Great, thank you both. Looking at both the chat and participants, I don't see any hands raised or additional questions, so I'll do a call for a final question. We'll give individuals a few more seconds if they are typing in the chat. During that time, just as a reminder, that we will be posting this to the University of Puget Sound's alumni and parent relations website. It will be up most likely next week, as we'll have to caption the video. And it looks like that we do have two more questions that came in. First one is from the Tomlin family. So Tomlin family, I will come down and unmute you, and we'll also ask that the Tomlin family be the last question. Kathy, I see yours as well. But that yours is tied to the Tomlin family's question.
Okay, well, I think I can word both of them together. Could you both address possible interference from overseas in the voting process itself? And Catherine wanted to put in deliberate domestic attempts to sway the voting process itself, such as voter suppression. Thanks very much.
Michael, do you want to tackle that? Because you've talked a lot about voter suppression issues.
Yeah. One thing that I will say is that I always try to begin conversations like this by saying that voter fraud is not real, because that is the rationale that is used to justify policies which engage in voter suppression, that they are designed to stop, individual or organized voter fraud. And that's just something that you just don't have evidence that that happens. One of the reasons why I am not super concerned about an attack on voting systems is that we don't have a singular voting system. That we have lots and lots of different voting systems and counties and precincts throughout this country. And so if we had a more centralized system that would be easy to target, that would be one thing, but we don't have that. We have a more distributed system of voting. And so I think that the odds of that happening are relatively small. I think that's why you see countries like Russia, for example, trying to engage in misinformation campaign or trying to sow division on online platforms. It's really not worthwhile and perhaps even not possible to engage in kind of sweeping attacks on our voting systems. That being said, as I was mentioning before, voter suppression is real. And that's something that scares me quite a bit. Voter identification laws throughout the country, changes to requirements for registrations, all of those things, have been designed politically to create certain types of outcomes. And the justification for implementing those policies is often just, it isn't borne out in the facts, which is that, voter fraud is not real. And so I do worry in each election about the disenfranchisement of voters. I worry especially about what things are going to look like in the fall if the pandemic is still happening, and states that are going to force people to come out to the polls in a way that might endanger their health, because one party or one candidate pushes hard because they believe that higher turnout is going to impact their chances of winning negatively. I worry about that. Mike, did you have anything you wanted to add there?
No, I think you addressed that well. Thanks.
And with that, I just wanted to again extend a thank you to both Mike and Michael. It is always an absolute pleasure to hear from you. And then as a reminder, our next lecture will be on September 17th. With that, Puget Sound and campus, thank you all very much and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.